This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Guardian is a British national daily newspaper, known until 1959 as the Manchester Guardian, along with its sister papers The Observer and The Guardian Weekly. The Guardian is part of the Guardian Media Group, owned by the Scott Trust Limited. The trust was created in 1936 to secure the financial and editorial independence of The Guardian in perpetuity and to safeguard the journalistic freedom and liberal values of The Guardian free from commercial or political interference. The Scott Trust became a limited company in 2008, with a constitution to maintain the same protections for The Guardian. Profits are reinvested in journalism rather than to the benefit of an owner or shareholders. The Guardian is edited by Catherine Viner, who succeeded Alan Rusbridger in 2015. The newspaper has a UK online edition as well as two international websites, Guardian Australia and Guardian US. As of August 2013, The Guardian's print edition had an average daily circulation of roughly 189,000 copies, behind the Daily Telegraph and The Times, and ahead of The Independent. The newspaper's online edition was the fifth most widely read in the world as of October 2014, with over 426 million readers in the UK. Its combined print and online editions reach nearly 9 million readers. Notable scoops include the 2011 News International phone hacking scandal, in particular the hacking of murdered teenager Millie Dowler's phone. The investigation led to the closure of one of the highest circulation newspapers in the world, The News of the World. The newspaper also released news of the secret collection of Verizon telephone records held by Barack Obama's administration in June 2013, and subsequently revealed the existence of the PRISM surveillance program after it was leaked to the paper by NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden. The Guardian was also named Newspaper of the Year in the 2014 British Press Awards for reporting on government surveillance. The paper is still occasionally referred to by its nickname of the Graniad, given originally for the purported frequency of its typographical errors. Content 1 History 11 1821 to 1972 111 Early Years 112 C.P. Scott 113 Spanish Civil War 114 Postwar 12 1972 to 2000 121 Northern Ireland 122 Sarah Tisdall 123 First Gulf War 124 Alleged penetration by Russian intelligence 125 Jonathan Aitken 126 Kosovo 13 Since 2000 131 Accusations of anti-Semitism and bias in coverage of Israel 132 Clark County 133 Guardian America 134 Gagged from reporting Parliament 135 Edward Snowden leaks and intervention by the UK government 136 Coverage of Iran 2 Ownership and Finances 21 Membership Subscription Scheme 3 Political Stance and Editorial Opinion 4 Circulation and Format 41 Publication History 42 Moving to the Berliner Paper Format 421 Reception 5 Regular Content and Features 51 G2 and Other Supplements 52 Regular Cartoon Strips 6 Online Media 7 Guardian Films 8 References in Popular Culture 9 Awards 91 Received 92 Given 10 Editors 11 Notable Regular Contributors Past and Present 12 Guardian News 1821 to 1972 Early Years Manchester Guardian Prospectus 1821 The Manchester Guardian was founded in Manchester in 1821 by cotton merchant John Edward Taylor with backing from the Little Circle, a group of non-conformist businessmen. They launched their paper after the police closure of the more radical Manchester Observer, the paper that had championed the cause of the Peterloo Massacre protesters. Taylor had been hostile to the radical reformers, writing, "They have appealed not to the reason but the passions and the suffering of their abused and credulous fellow countrymen, from whose ill-requited industry they extort for themselves the means of a plentiful and comfortable existence. They do not toil, neither do they spin, but they live better than those that do." When the government closed down the Manchester Observer, the mill owners' champions had the upper hand. The influential journalist Jeremiah Garnett joined Taylor during the establishment of the paper, and all of the Little Circle wrote articles for the new paper. The prospectus announcing the new publication proclaimed that it would zealously enforce the principles of civil and religious liberty. Without reference to the party from which they emanate, all serviceable measures. In 1825 the paper merged with the British Volunteer and was known as the Manchester Guardian and British Volunteer until 1828 the working-class Manchester and Salford Advertiser called the Manchester Guardian the foul prostitute and dirty parasite of the worst portion of the mill owners. The Manchester Guardian was generally hostile to Labour's claims of the 1832 Ten Hours Bill. The paper doubted whether, in view of the foreign competition, the passing of a law positively enacting a gradual destruction of the cotton manufacture in this kingdom would be a much less rational procedure. The Manchester Guardian dismissed strikes as the work of outside agitators. The paper's moderate editorial line became more radical, supporting Gladstone when the Liberals split in 1886, and opposing the Second Boer War against popular opinion. Scott supported the movement for women's suffrage, but was critical of any tactics by the suffragettes that involved direct action. The really ludicrous position is that Mr. Lloyd George is fighting to enfranchise 7 million women, and the militants are smashing unoffending people's windows and breaking up benevolent societies' meetings in a desperate effort to prevent him. Scott thought the suffragettes' courage and devotion was worthy of a better cause and saner leadership. It has been argued that Scott's criticism reflected a widespread disdain, at the time, for those women who transgressed the gender expectations of Edwardian society. Scott commissioned J.M. Singh and his friend Jack Yates to produce articles and drawings documenting the social conditions of the West of Ireland pre-First World War, and these pieces were published in 1911 in the collection Travels in Wicklow, West Kerry and Connemara. Scott's friendship with Chaim Weizmann played a role in the Balfour Declaration of 1917, and in 1948 the Manchester Guardian was a supporter of the new State of Israel. In June 1936, ownership of the paper passed to the Scott Trust, named after the last owner, John Russell Scott, who was the first chairman of the trust. This move ensured the paper's independence. Spanish Civil War, traditionally affiliated with the centrist-to-center-left Liberal Party, and with a northern, non-conformist circulation base, the paper earned a national reputation and the respect of the left during the Spanish Civil War with the pro-liberal News Chronicle, the labor-supporting Daily Herald, the Communist Party's Daily Worker and several Sunday and weekly papers. It supported the Republican government against General Francisco Franco's insurgent nationalists post-war. The paper so loathed Labor's left-wing champion Aneurin Bevin and the hate gospelers of his entourage that it called for Attlee's post-war Labour government to be voted out of office. The newspaper opposed the creation of the National Health Service as it feared the state provision of healthcare would eliminate selective elimination and lead to an increase of congenitally deformed and feckless people. The Manchester Guardian strongly opposed military intervention during the 1956 Suez Crisis, the Anglo-French ultimatum to Egypt as an act of folly, without justification in any terms but brief expediency. It pours petrol on a growing fire. There is no knowing what kind of explosion will follow. 1972-2000. Northern Ireland. When 13 civil rights demonstrators in Northern Ireland were killed by British soldiers on 30 January 1972, known as Bloody Sunday, The Guardian said that neither side can escape condemnation. Of the protesters, they wrote, the organisers of the demonstration, Miss Bernadette Devlin among them, deliberately challenged the ban on marches. They knew that stone throwing and sniping could not be prevented, and that the IRA might use the crowd as a shield. Of the army, they wrote, there seems little doubt that random shots were fired into the crowd, that aim was taken at individuals who were neither bombers nor weapons carriers, and that excessive force was used. Many Irish people believed that the Widgery Tribunal's ruling on the killings was a whitewash, a view that was later supported with the publication of the Seville Inquiry in 2010, but in 1972 The Guardian declared that Widgery's report is not one-sided. The 20th of April 1972 The paper at the time also supported internment without trial in Northern Ireland. Internment without trial is hateful, repressive and undemocratic in the existing Irish situation. Most regrettably, it is also inevitable to remove the ringleaders, in the hope that the atmosphere might calm down, is a step to which there is no obvious alternative. And before then, The Guardian had called for British troops to be sent to the region. British soldiers could present a more disinterested face of law and order, but only on condition that Britain takes charge. Sarah Tisdall. In 1983 The paper was at the center of a controversy surrounding documents regarding the stationing of cruise missiles in Britain that were leaked to The Guardian by civil servant Sarah Tisdall. The paper eventually complied with a court order to hand over the documents to the authorities, which resulted in a six-month prison sentence for Tisdall, though she served only four. "I still blame myself," said Peter Preston, who was the editor of The Guardian at the time, but he went on to argue that the paper had no choice because it believed in the rule of law. First Gulf War. In the lead up to the First Gulf War, between 1990 and 1991, The Guardian expressed doubts about military action against Iraq. Frustration in the Gulf leads temptingly to the invocation of task forces and tactical bombing, but the military option is no option at all. The emergence yesterday of a potential hostage problem of vast dimensions only emphasized that this is far too complex a crisis for gunboat diplomacy. Loose talk of carpet bombing Baghdad should be put back in the bottle of theoretical but unacceptable scenarios. But on the eve of the war, the paper rallied to the war cause. The simple cause, at the end, is just an evil regime in Iraq instituted an evil and brutal invasion. Our soldiers and airmen are there, at UN behest, to set that evil to rights. Their duties are clear. Court case proceeded, and in 1997 The Guardian produced evidence that Aitken's claim of his wife paying for the hotel stay was untrue. In 1999, Aitken was jailed for perjury and perverting the course of justice. Kosovo. The paper supported NATO's military intervention in the Kosovo War in 1999, though the United Nations Security Council did not support the action. The Guardian stated that the only honorable course for Europe and America is to use military force. Mary Caldor's piece was headlined, Bombs Away. But to save civilians, we must get in some soldiers too. Since 2000, The Guardian senior news writer Esther Adley interviewing Ecuadorian Foreign Minister Ricardo Patiño for an article relating to Julian Assange in 2014. In the early 2000s, The Guardian challenged the Act of Settlement 1701 and the Treason Felony Act 1848. In October 2004, The Guardian published a humorous column by Charlie Brooker in its entertainment guide, which appeared to call for the assassination of George W. Bush. This caused some controversy and the paper was forced to issue an apology and remove the article from its website following the 7 July 2005 London bombings. The Guardian published an article on its comment pages by Dilpazir Aslam, a 27-year-old British Muslim and journalism trainee from Yorkshire. Aslam was a member of Hizb ut-Tahrir, an Islamist group, and had published a number of articles on their website. According to the paper, it did not know that Aslam was a member of Hizb ut-Tahrir when he applied to become a trainee, though several staff members were informed of this once he started at the paper. The Home Office has claimed the group's ultimate aim is the establishment of an Islamic State caliphate, according to Hizb ut-Tahrir, via non-violent means. The Guardian asked Aslam to resign his membership of the group and, when he did not do so, terminated his employment in early 2009. The paper started a tax investigation into a number of major UK companies, including publishing a database of the tax paid by the FTSE 100 companies. Internal documents relating to Barclays Bank's tax avoidance were removed from the Guardian website after Barclays obtained a gagging order. The paper played a pivotal role in exposing the depth of the News of the World phone hacking affair. The Economist's Intelligent Life magazine opined that, as Watergate is to the Washington Post, and thalidomide to the Sunday Times, so phone hacking will surely be to the Guardian, a defining moment in its history. Accusations of anti-Semitism and bias in coverage of Israel. In recent decades, The Guardian has been accused of biased criticism of Israeli government policy. In December 2003, columnist Julie Burkhill cited striking bias against the State of Israel as one of the reasons she left the paper for The Times. A leaked report from the European Monitoring Center on Racism cited The Economist's claim that for many British Jews, the British media's reporting on Israel is spiced with a tone of animosity, as to smell of anti-Semitism. Wrong to state that Tel Aviv. Guardian America. In 2007, the paper launched Guardian America, an attempt to capitalize on its large online readership in the United States, which at the time stood at more than 59 million. The company hired former American Prospect editor, New York Magazine columnist and New York Review of Books writer Michael Tomasky to head the project and hire a staff of American reporters and web editors. The site featured news from The Guardian that was relevant to an American audience, coverage of U.S. news and the Middle East. For example, Tomasky stepped down from his position as editor of Guardian America in February 2009, ceding editing and planning duties to other U.S. and London staff. He retained his position as a columnist and blogger, taking the title editor at large in October 2009. The company abandoned the Guardian America homepage, instead directing users to a U.S. news index page on the main Guardian website. The following month, the company laid off 6 American employees, including a reporter, a multimedia producer, and 4 web editors. The move came as Guardian News and Media opted to reconsider its U.S. strategy amid a huge effort to cut costs across the company in subsequent years. However, The Guardian has hired various commentators on U.S. affairs, including Anna Marie Cox, Michael Wolff, Naomi Wolf, Glenn Greenwald, and former George W. Bush's speechwriter Josh Trevino. Trevino's first blog post was an apology for a controversial tweet posted in June 2011 over the second Gaza flotilla. The controversy, which had been revived by the appointment Guardian US launched in September 2011, led by editor-in-chief Janine Gibson, which replaced the previous Guardian America service after a period during which Catherine Viner served as the US editor-in-chief before taking charge of Guardian News and Media as a whole. Viner's former deputy, Lee Glendinning, was appointed to succeed her as head of the American operation at the beginning of June 2015, gagged from reporting Parliament in October 2009. The Guardian reported that it was forbidden to report on a parliamentary matter, a question recorded in a Commons Order paper, to be answered by a minister later that week. The paper noted that it was being forbidden from telling its readers why the paper is prevented, for the first time in memory, from reporting Parliament legal obstacles, which cannot be identified, involve proceedings, which cannot be mentioned, on behalf of a client who must remain secret. The only fact The Guardian can report is that the case involves the London solicitors Carter Ruck. The paper further claimed that this case appears to call into question privileges guaranteeing free speech established under the 1688 Bill of Rights. The only parliamentary question mentioning Carter Ruck in the relevant period was by Paul Farrelly MP, in reference to legal action by Barclays and Trafigura. The part of the question referencing Carter Ruck relates to the latter company's September 2009 gagging order on the publication of a 2006 internal report into the 2006 Côte d'Ivoire toxic waste dump scandal, which involved a class action case that the company only settled in September 2009 after The Guardian published some of the commodity traders' internal emails. The reporting injunction was lifted the next day, as Carter Ruck withdrew it before The Guardian could challenge it in the High Court. Alan Rusbridger credited the rapid backdown of Carter Ruck to Twitter, as did a BBC article. Edward Snowden leaks and intervention by the UK government. In June 2013, the newspaper broke news of the secret collection of Verizon telephone records held by Barack Obama's administration in June 2013, and subsequently revealed the existence of the PRISM surveillance program after it was leaked to the paper by former NSA contractor Edward Snowden. The newspaper was subsequently contacted by the British government's cabinet secretary, Sir Jeremy Haywood, under instruction from the Prime Minister David Cameron and Deputy Prime Minister Nick Clegg, who ordered that the hard drives containing the information be destroyed. The Guardian's offices were then visited in July by agents from the UK's GCHQ, who supervised the destruction of the hard drives containing information acquired from Snowden in June 2014. The Register reported that the information the government sought to suppress by destroying the hard drives related to the location of a beyond top secret internet monitoring base in Sebe, Oman, and the close involvement of BT and Cable Intercepting Internet Communications coverage of Iran. A 2015 study alleged that The Guardian was just as biased as Iranian media Tehran Times and Fars News Agency in their coverage of events related to the Iranian nuclear crisis. In 2012, The Guardian featured more physical actions from Iranian-based actors and verbal actions from U.S. and European government officials, and naturalized the sanctions against Iran by removing the agency of the U.S. and its allies' ownership and finances. The Guardian is part of the Guardian Media Group GMG of newspapers, radio stations and print media, including The Observer Sunday newspaper, The Guardian Weekly International newspaper, and New Media, Guardian Abroad website, and Guardian Cook. All the aforementioned were owned by the Scott Trust, a charitable foundation existing between 1936 and 2008, which aimed to ensure the paper's editorial independence in perpetuity, maintaining its financial health to ensure it did not become vulnerable to takeovers by for-profit media groups. At the beginning of October 2008, the Scott Trust's assets were transferred to a new limited company, the Scott Trust Limited, with the intention being that the original trust would be wound up. Dame Liz Forgan, chair of the Scott Trust, reassured staff that the purposes of the new company remained the same as under the previous arrangements. The Guardian has been consistently loss-making. The national newspaper division of GMG, which also includes The Observer, reported operating losses of £499 million in 2006, up from £186 million in 2005. The paper is therefore heavily dependent on cross-subsidization from profitable companies within the group. The Guardian's headquarters in London. The Guardian's ownership by the Scott Trust is probably a factor in its being the only British national daily to conduct since 2003 an annual social, ethical and environmental audit in which it examines, under the scrutiny of an independent external auditor, its own behavior as a company. It is also the only British national daily newspaper to employ an internal ombudsman called the «Reader's Editor» to handle complaints and corrections. The Guardian and its parent groups participate in Project Syndicate, established by George Soros, and intervened in 1995 to save the Mail. In June 2011, Guardian News and Media revealed increased annual losses of £33 million and announced that it was looking to focus on its online edition for news coverage, leaving the print edition to contain more comments and features. It was also speculated that The Guardian might become the first British national daily paper to be fully online for the 3 years up to June 2012. The paper lost £100,000 a day, which prompted Intelligent Life to question whether The Guardian could survive between 2007 and 2014. The Guardian Media Group sold all their side businesses, of regional papers and online portals for classifieds and consolidated, into The Guardian as sole product. The sales let them acquire a capital stock of £8,383 million as of July 2014, supposed to guarantee the independence of The Guardian in perpetuity. In the first year, the paper made more losses than predicted, and in January 2016 the publishers announced that The Guardian will cut 20% of staff and costs within the next 3 years. Membership subscription scheme. In 2014, The Guardian launched a membership scheme. The scheme aims to reduce the financial losses incurred by The Guardian without introducing a paywall, thus maintaining open access to the website. Website readers can pay a monthly subscription, with three tiers available: political stance and editorial opinion. Founded by textile traders and merchants, The Guardian had a reputation as an organ of the middle class, or in the words of C.P. Scott's son Ted, a paper that will remain bourgeois to the last. "I write for The Guardian," said Sir Max Hastings in 2005, "because it is read by the new establishment," reflecting the paper's then-growing influence. The Scott Trust describes one of its core purposes to be to secure the financial and editorial independence of The Guardian in perpetuity, as a quality national newspaper without party affiliation, remaining faithful to its liberal tradition. The paper's readership is generally on the mainstream left of British political opinion. A Mori poll taken between April and June 2000 showed that 80% of Guardian readers were Labour Party voters. According to another Mori poll taken in 2005, 48% of Guardian readers were Labour voters and 34% Liberal Democrat voters. The newspaper's reputation as a platform for liberal and left-wing opinions has led to the use of the epithets Guardian reader and Guardianista for people holding such views, or as a negative stereotype of such people as middle class, earnest and politically correct. Although the paper is often considered to be linked inextricably to the Labour Party, three of The Guardian's four leader writers joined the more centrist Social Democratic Party on its foundation in 1981. The paper was enthusiastic in its support for Tony Blair in his successful bid to lead the Labour Party, and to be elected Prime Minister. Then Guardian features editor Ian Katz, asserted in 2004 that "it is no secret we are a centre-left newspaper." In 2008, Guardian columnist Jackie Ashley said that editorial contributors were a mix of right-of-centre libertarians, Greens, Blairites, Brownites, Labourite but less enthusiastic Brownites, etc., and that the newspaper was clearly left-of-centre and vaguely progressive. She also said that "you can be absolutely certain that come the next general election, The Guardian's stance will not be dictated by the editor, still less any foreign proprietor. It helps that there isn't one, but will be the result of vigorous debate within the paper." The paper's comment and opinion pages, though often written by centre-left contributors such as Polly Toynbee, have allowed some space for right-of-centre voices such as Max Hastings and Michael Gove. Since an editorial in 2000, The Guardian has favoured abolition of the British monarchy in the run-up to the 2010 general election. Following a meeting of the editorial staff, the paper declared its support for the Liberal Democrats, due in particular to the party's stance on electoral reform. The paper suggested tactical voting to prevent a Conservative victory victory, given Britain's first passed the post-electoral system at the 2015 election, the paper switched its support to the Labour Party. The paper argued that Britain needed a new direction and Labour speaks with more urgency than its rivals on social justice, standing up to predatory capitalism, on investment for growth, on reforming and strengthening the public realm, Britain's place in Europe and international development. Assistant editor Michael White, in discussing media self-censorship in March 2011, says, "I have always sensed liberal, middle-class ill-ease in going after stories about immigration, legal or otherwise, about welfare fraud or the less attractive tribal habits of the working class, which is more easily ignored altogether. Toffs, including royal ones, Christians, especially popes, governments of Israel, and U.S. Republicans are more straightforward targets." In a 2013 interview for NPR, The Guardian's Latin America correspondent Rory Carroll stated that many editors at The Guardian believed and continue to believe that they should support Hugo Chavez because he was a standard-bearer for the left. In the 2015 Labour Party leadership election, The Guardian supported Yvette Cooper and was critical of left-winger Jeremy Corbyn, the successful candidate. Although the majority of political columnists in The Guardian were against Corbyn winning, Owen Jones, Sumas Milne and George Monbiot wrote supportive articles about him. Circulation and format: The Guardian had a certified average daily circulation of 204,222 copies in December 2012. Average daily circulation had fallen to 193,586. According to the Audit Bureau of Circulation's publication history, this section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. March 2016. Learn how and when to remove this template message. The Guardian's Newsroom Visitor Center and Archive No. 60, with an old sign with the name The Manchester Guardian. The first edition was published on 5 May 1821, at which time The Guardian was a weekly, published on Saturdays and costing 7d. The stamp duty on newspapers 4d per sheet forced the price up so high that it was uneconomic to publish more frequently. When the stamp duty was cut in 1836, The Guardian added a Wednesday edition, and with the abolition of the tax in 1855 it became a daily paper costing 2d in 1952. The paper took the step of printing news on the front page, replacing the adverts that had hitherto filled that space. Then editor A.P. Wadsworth wrote, "It is not a thing I like myself, but it seems to be accepted by all the newspaper pundits that it is preferable to be in fashion." In 1959, the paper dropped Manchester from its title, becoming simply The Guardian, and in 1964 it moved to London, losing some of its regional agenda but continuing to be heavily subsidised by sales of the more downmarket but more profitable Manchester Evening News. The financial position remained extremely poor into the 1970s. At one time it was in merger talks with The Times. The paper consolidated its centre-left stance during the 1970s and 1980s but was both shocked and revitalised by the launch of The Independent in 1986, which competed for a similar readership and provoked the entire broadsheet industry into a fight for circulation. On 12 February 1988, The Guardian had a significant redesign, as well as improving the quality of its printer's ink. It also changed its masthead to a juxtaposition of an italic Garamond, the, with a bold Helvetica, Guardian, that remained in use until the 2005 redesign in 1992. The Guardian relaunched its features section as G2, a tabloid format supplement. This innovation was widely copied by the other quality broadsheets and ultimately led to the rise of compact papers and The Guardian's move to the Berliner format in 1993. The paper declined to participate in the broadsheet price war started by Rupert Murdoch's The Times in June 1993. The Guardian bought The Observer from Lonro, thus gaining a serious Sunday sister newspaper with similar political views. Its international weekly edition is now titled The Guardian Weekly, though it retained the title Manchester Guardian Weekly for some years after the home edition had moved to London. It includes sections from a number of other internationally significant newspapers of a somewhat left-of-centre inclination, including Le Monde and The Washington Post. The Guardian Weekly was also linked to a website for expatriates, Guardian Abroad, which was launched in 2007 but had been taken offline by 2012. Moving to the Berliner paper format, The Guardian is printed in full colour, and was the first newspaper in the UK to use the Berliner format for its main section, while producing sections and supplements in a range of page sizes including tabloid, approximately A4, and pocket size approximately A5 in 2004, The Guardian announced plans to change to a Berliner or MIDI format, similar to that used by Die Tageszeitung in Germany, Le Monde in France and many other European papers at 470x315. Height gives more flexibility in page design. The new presses mean that printing can go across the strip down the middle of the center page, known as the gutter, allowing the paper to print striking double-page pictures. The new presses also made it the first UK national paper to print in full colour on every page. The format switch was accompanied by a comprehensive redesign of the paper's look on Friday, 9 September 2005. The newspaper unveiled its newly designed front page, which debuted on Monday, 12 September 2005, designed by Mark Porter. The new look includes a new masthead for the newspaper, its first since 1988. A typeface family designed by Paul Barnes and Christian Schwartz was created for the new design with just over 200 fonts. It is one of the most ambitious custom type programs ever commissioned by a newspaper. Especially notable is Guardian Egyptian, a highly legible slab serif that is used in various weights for both text and headlines and is central to the redesign. The switch cost Guardian newspapers £80. Format reception. The new format was generally well received by Guardian readers, who were encouraged to provide feedback on the changes. The only controversy was over the dropping of the Doonesbury cartoon strip. The paper reported thousands of calls and emails complaining about its loss. Within 24 hours the decision was reversed and the strip was reinstated the following week. G2 supplement editor Ian Katz, who was responsible for dropping it, apologized in the editor's blog saying, "I'm sorry, once again, that I made you, and the hundreds of fellow fans who have called our helpline or mailed our comments address, so cross." Some readers were, however, dissatisfied as the earlier deadline needed for the all-color sports section meant that coverage of late-finishing evening football matches became less satisfactory in the editions supplied to some parts of the country. The investment was rewarded with a circulation rise in December 2005. The average daily sale stood at 380,693, nearly 6% higher than the figure for December 2004. However, as of December 2012, circulation has since dropped to 204,222 in 2006. The US-based Society for News Design chose The Guardian and Polish daily Rzeczpospolita as the world's best designed newspapers, from among 389 entries from 44 countries. Regular content and features. On each weekday The Guardian comes with the G2 supplement containing feature articles, columns, television and radio listings, and the quick crossword. Since the change to the Berliner format, there is a separate daily sports section. Other regular supplements during the week are shown below. Before the redesign in 2005, the main news section was in the large broadsheet format, but the supplements were all in the half-sized tabloid format, with the exception of the glossy weekend section, which was a 290x245. Main part of the paper. G2 and other supplements. This section needs to be updated. Please update this article to reflect recent events or newly available information. March 2016. The following sections are in G2 every day from Monday to Friday: Arts, TV and Radio, Puzzles Monday in G2, Charlie Brooker's column Ask Hadley, Fashion Advice from Hadley Freeman, Media Guardian, Media Monkey, Gossip from the Media Sector Tuesday, Education Guardian Wednesday in G2, The Digested Read, by John Cray. Society Guardian covers the British public sector and related issues. Thursday in G2, Private Lives Notes. Review covers literature, cinema, the arts, travel, family, sport, cook. Regular cartoon strips. If by Steve Bell. Doonesbury Loomis, by Stephen Appleby. Saturday, in the family section. Claire in the community. Wednesday, in the society section. Home Clubber. Saturday, in the guide section. Editorial cartoonists Martin Rosen and Steve Bell have received hate mail for their treatment of topics that some deem controversial. Online media. Main article, The Guardian. The Guardian and its Sunday sibling The Observer publish all their news online, with free access both to current news and an archive of 3 million stories. A third of the site's hits are for items over a month old. As of May 2013, it was the most popular UK newspaper website with 82 meters unique visitors per month, just ahead of Mail Online with 76 meters unique monthly visitors in April 2011. MediaWeek reported that The Guardian was the fifth most popular newspaper site in the world. The Comment is Free section features columns by the paper's journalists and regular commentators, as well as articles from guest writers, including readers' comments and responses. Below the section includes all the opinion pieces published in the paper itself, as well as many others that only appear online. Censorship is exercised by moderators who can ban posts. The paper has also launched a dating website, Soulmates, and is experimenting with new media, having previously offered a free 12-part weekly podcast series by Ricky Gervais in January 2006. Gervais' show topped the iTunes podcast chart, having been downloaded by 2 million listeners worldwide, and was scheduled to be listed in the 2007 Guinness Book of Records as the most downloaded podcast. Guardian Films in 2003. The Guardian started the film production company Guardian Films, headed by journalist Maggie O'Kane. Much of the company's output is documentary made for television, and it has included Salam Pax's Baghdad Blogger for BBC Two's daily flagship Newsnight, some of which have been shown in compilations by CNN International, Sex on the Streets and Spiked, both made for the UK's Channel 4 television. Guardian Films was born in a sleeping bag in the Burmese rainforest, wrote O'Kane in 2003. I was a foreign correspondent for the paper, and it had taken me weeks of negotiations, dealing with shady contacts and a lot of walking to reach the cigar-smoking Karen twins, the boy soldiers who were leading attacks against the country's ruling junta. After I had reached them and written a cover story for the newspaper's G2 section, I got a call from the BBC's documentary department, which was researching a film on child soldiers. Could I give them all my contacts? The plight of the Karen people, who were forced into slave labor in the rainforest to build pipelines for oil companies, some of them British, was a tale of human suffering that needed to be told by any branch of the media that was interested. I handed over all the names and numbers I had, as well as details of the secret route through Thailand to get into Burma. Good girl afterwards, and not for the first time it seemed to me that we at The Guardian should be using our resources ourselves instead of providing contact numbers for any independent TV company prepared to get on the phone to a journalist. We should make our own films. According to Guardian Films' own webpage, its international work has focused on training talented local journalists based on the premise that the era of a traditional London or Washington-based foreign correspondent or fireman is coming to an end, and the world urgently needs a more searching, challenging journalism brought to us by people who speak the language and can secure access far beyond the green zone journalist limits of the traditional correspondent. It says it is especially focused on reporting the Muslim world in a more challenging manner, and has trained a number of journalists in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Zimbabwe. Guardian Films has received several broadcasting awards in addition to two Amnesty International Media Awards in 2004 and 2005. The Baghdad blogger, Salam Pax, won a Royal Television Society Award in 2005. Baghdad, A Doctor's Story, won an Emmy Award for Best International Current Affairs Film in 2007. In 2008, photojournalist Sean Smith's Inside the Surge won the Royal Television Society Award for Best International News Film. Sent to London by train may have contributed as well to this image. When John Cole was appointed news editor by Alistair Hetherington in 1963, he sharpened the paper's comparatively amateurish setup. Awards received: The Guardian has been awarded the National Newspaper of the Year in 1999, 2005, 2010 and 2013 by the British Press Awards, and Front Page of the Year in 2002, a declaration of war. The 12th of September 2001, it was also co-winner of the World's Best Designed Newspaper as awarded by the Society for News Design. 2006, Guardian journalists have won a range of British press awards, including Reporter of the Year, Nick Davies, 1999, Paul Lewis, 2009, Rob Evans, 2010, Cartoonist of the Year, Steve Bell, 2002, Political Journalist of the Year, Patrick Wintour, 2006, Andrew Sparrow, 2010, Science,